Well, hello, and thank you for joining us today for the Calvary Conversations podcast. We thank you for taking time to stop by and to listen, and we trust that God's going to speak to you today and encourage your life. If you enjoy the content, would you please hit the subscribe button and then share it on social media and encourage and invite people, friends, and family to join us each week on Fridays at 6 p.m. We are really grateful to have you with us today. Today's going to be a great podcast. The topic is going to be on resisting the enemy, resisting the devil. And we have a special guest conversationalist with us today, my daughter, Candace. And so good to have you, Candace.
Yeah, so good to be here. Always love it.
All right. Well, pray that God will speak to you. And in fact, we just want to open up in prayer as we start this podcast together today. So let's just pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to just speak together about the things of God, to share your word with all that would listen and join us on this weekly podcast. Lord, we just pray your blessings on each listener, God. We ask you to bless this conversation today. I pray that you would speak something through Candace and myself, God, that would encourage, bless, and draw people closer to you, as well as just give insight to us, God, on how to overcome and resist the enemy when he attacks our mind, our will, our emotions. Lord, I pray that your word would just be life to us today. We thank you for this time together. Bless the conversation in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, I'm really glad that Candace is here. And Candace, I was remembering and preparing for this this conversation today that a few years ago you had a real spiritual attack, and the enemy came against your mind and began to bombard you and cause some question and confusion. And of course, your mother and I, we prayed with you and gave you some counsel, and we just went to spiritual warfare with you. But share that a little bit with us, and then we're going to jump into the topic about how to resist the devil.
Yeah, and when I was presented with this topic, this is something that is everybody will face at some point in life, maybe even multiple times, where there's a season of where the enemy's attacking and there just seems like there's no hope and you want to give up and you feel like there's no way out. And so I was feeling all these feelings several years ago. I was in middle school, kind of like a couple of year period there, 12, 13, 14 years old, where I was just like, I was lost. I wasn't sure what to do. And I had given into some temptations, and the enemy, I felt like, was on all sides of me, speaking lies to my head. And I started to believe some of them. And that's when I really had this time where I couldn't sleep at night. I would spend many hours of the night coming to my parents' bedrooms, you know, even sleeping in their bedroom, because I was terrified to be alone with the enemy trying to lie and make me fearful of everything. And so this happened on and off throughout a couple year period, but constantly I'd go to my parents and they would pray for me and they would intercede for me. And there was a point where, you know, nobody really in our church knew what was going on, but my parents told specific people, and they were praying for me. So I knew that there were people in our community praying for me. And it was a spiritual warfare, something that, you know, you don't think a 14-year-old girl could face, but it was a struggle. And I thought, you know, I was like, why am I facing this? I would constantly, you know, ask God, why do I feel like I have no victory? And it was through prayer and through fighting with you guys and really just coming against the devil with the word of God. And so I think that's what, if any platform or if any kind of thing I would like the listeners to walk away with today, is that I believe that I won that spiritual battle, or God won that spiritual battle, through the declaration of the word of God over that situation, over that attack from the enemy. And it took a little while. It took a little bit of faith and a little bit of hope and pressing on, because I felt like there was no way out, but God was with me. And it was a victorious experience afterwards. And looking back on it, I'm constantly grateful for God and for his word that is never ending and was my rock during that time.
Amen. And to be clear, she wasn't fighting with us. We were fighting alongside of her spiritually, yes, is what she was implying there. You know, James 4:7 says this. It says, humble yourself before God. And then the second part is resist the devil and he will flee from you. But there's that first part about humbling yourself before God. And, you know, as I look back, you truly did that. I remember those that year or so that you were going through that, and you weren't trying to do this on your own. I mean, you were confused and you had some doubt, and but you always came and you always asked your mom and I, please pray with me again. It's just that humbling yourself, going to God and saying, Lord, I don't know why, I don't know how, I don't know what this is all about, but I know, God, that you know. Right. And when you trust the Lord and you keep going to him, you keep knocking, you keep asking, you keep seeking, he responds.
Yeah.
And he surely did do that. You know, everyone, you said this a minute ago, but everyone either already has been through a battle like this, or they are presently going through a battle like this, or they are just about to go through a battle like this, because it happens to everybody. And no one is exempt from the snare and the lie and the trap of the enemy. He lays those traps out for everyone. So I've discovered that, you know, Satan will try to tempt us or ensnare us in about three different ways. Of course, there are many ways that he will come against us, but three specific ways that seem to be very common are trials. Can be like financial trials, relationship trials, whatever, but any kind of trial. And then, of course, temptations to do what is wrong, temptations to enjoy the pleasure of sin for the season that the Bible says exists, but it's short-lived. And then sickness. He attacks body with sickness and disease and like that. And when Satan gets the upper hand, it's often an indication that somehow we've allowed, or we've kind of allowed ourselves to not be in prayer, to not be maybe in fellowship with other believers. People, you mentioned earlier in sharing your testimony that you came to Mom and I, but you also knew that together we had gone to some other very faith-filled people and said, pray with us. And whenever we withdraw from that faith community, when we withdraw from the support that God gives us through his body, through the body of Christ, we put ourselves in a place where we are vulnerable to these attacks. And so what I have found is that when Satan begins to get the upper hand and we begin to face these attacks, sometimes it's because we have withdrawn ourselves and we find ourselves in a real weakened place.
Yeah, no, that's so true. And I have seen not a consistent pattern, but there's certain times in my life where you see this vulnerability of maybe not spending consistent time with the Lord and kind of drawing away from that place. And you do leave yourself open for the enemy to take that and start speaking those lies, start, you know, attacking from different sides of your life, whether that's family, finances, whatever it is. And so for me, several years ago, that's kind of what happened. I had not been consistent. I had kind of maybe slipped away a little bit, distanced myself maybe a little bit. And that's when the enemy attacked. And I knew that's what that was the reason. And that's why, you know, I remember you and Mom saying, you got to get in God's word. It has to be consistent in your life. And so I remember those specifically, going back to how you're saying that no one is exempt from the snares of the enemy. I thought there was something wrong with me in that season. I'm like, there must be something wrong with me. But you and Mom consistently told me, you're not experiencing something that somebody else has not gone through. And that gave me a little bit of hope, knowing that, you know, everybody's going to face something and God is going to get you through it, you know, and there are people around you, like you said, that are going to go in that with you.
And absolutely. You. And if you're listening to this today and you're facing a battle right now, you're in this season of trial or temptation or sickness, and it is an attack of the enemy, you just need to recognize and realize that the verse we just shared from James says, resist him, humble yourself before God, resist the devil, and he will, not maybe, not might, but he will flee from you. It is a promise from God that the enemy does not get victory. And I just want to encourage someone listening that today is a day, this podcast might be a an inspiration for you to claim victory in your life, to go after it. So some ways, we just want to share a few ways to get that victory. Yeah. And ways to that you can resist or know how to resist the enemy of our soul. And the first thing I want us to talk about is that we have to know who God is. We have to know what his word says. We have to know what he says about himself and the way that he brings victory. We have to know who God is, but we also have to know who the enemy is. Mm-hmm. When we know God's word and we know what God says about us and we know what the word of God says about the enemy, it identifies him, then we can begin to attack him, mm-hmm. Counterattack him with our praise, yes. with our worship, with the word of God. And the fact is this, if you know who Satan is, he is a fallen angel. Mm-hmm. He is not God, but he is the author of sin. He is evil in every way. There's nothing good about him. Ezekiel 28 describes his fall from heaven. It describes the kind of being that he is and the evil that flows from him. And the Bible calls him sly. It calls him crafty. It calls him the master deceiver. And you can just look back at the very beginning of Scripture. You can look at Eve. And Satan comes to her, he lies to her. He speaks a lie, an untruth to her, complete false lie, to tempt her to partake of the fruit and that was forbidden. And she does it because of a lie. He begins mm-hmm. History with a lie. Mm-hmm. And so the truth is not in him. The Bible says he is the father of lies in John chapter 8, verse 44. It calls him the father of lies. It says this. Let me just read the verse. It says, "For you are the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things that he does." He was a murderer from the beginning. He has always hated the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, it is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and the mm-hmm. father of lies. When you know what the Bible says about him, you can know that whenever anything, only good things come from the Father, our exactly. Heavenly Father, God. So anything that's not good, that is not holy, that is not righteous, it is not from God. It is from the enemy. Whenever there is something that is coming against you that you know is not from God, then you know it's from the enemy. Right. Then you know it's a lie. And we do know, too, that Satan is powerful. Mm-hmm. But praise God, he is not all powerful. Exactly. And our God, greater is he who is in us yeah. than he who is in the world. Our God is all powerful. Ephesians 6, Paul writes this, it says, "For we are not fighting against flesh and blood. The enemy of our soul is not flesh and blood, but against the rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in the dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places." Satan is powerful. We need to know that mm-hmm. because if we just, you know, sometimes we picture Satan, you know, the devil as this little pitchfork red yeah. guy with horns, you know, and it's almost like a cute little character.
Yeah, and they've almost made it into like a fictional character in some yeah. ways, you know, but we have to identify what he is so we can, you know.
And that's not to give any credit or glory to him. Yeah. He is a fallen angel. He doesn't have all power, but he does have power. Mm-hmm. And he does have a agenda to draw each of us, lovers of Jesus, away from God and to cause us to sin. The Bible says he has power, but he has no divine attributes at all.
Yeah.
He is not God. Mm-hmm. And God is God. He yeah. is our Father, our Creator, and he loves us and he's going to take care of us. So in thinking about that, just understand that Satan does not have all power. He has some, but not all. He is not omnipresent. He cannot be everywhere mm-hmm. all the time like God is. And he is not eternal. He will be destroyed, the Bible says, and thrown into the lake of fire. Thank God for that. And by the way, the lake of fire, hell, was not created for any of us. It is not God's will. It is God's will that none of us would perish, but would come to repentance. So God yes. gives us his grace and his love to draw us to himself. But the lake of fire was intended for Satan and all the demons of hell. And they will be destroyed there. And he is not omniscient. He is not all-knowing. Satan does not know everything about us. In fact, and maybe you want to speak to this, mm-hmm. I think sometimes as Christians, we give a little power to Satan
right.
because of the things we say.
Yeah.
And I know we're just human and I know we talk and like that, but I think we could really learn a discipline of controlling our tongues
yes.
so that we don't let Satan in on too mm-hmm. much information. I learned that as a young person by a female evangelist named Pearl McDaniel. And she would preach and she preached powerfully under a great anointing, but she used to say, quit telling Satan all your business. He doesn't know yeah. everything about you. So
yeah, I think that is so important. I remember going through that season and I've learned a lifelong lesson because of it. But I remember being told, like, only God knows every detail about you. He knows what you're going through. He knows your business, as you were mentioning. And so there are these spiritual battles where we have to understand, we're talking about this now, who God is versus who the devil is. Because God is all powerful. He is omnipresent. He is omniscient. But the devil is not.
That's right.
So we have to stop giving credit to the enemy. And, you know, even daily, sometimes we can catch ourselves saying, oh, yeah, the devil's attacking me because this happened or because this happened or because I'm just having a bad day and the devil's doing this, and we're constantly talking about how the devil's attacking us. And yes, those attacks can be real, but I just want us to grab hold of how he's not all powerful. He's not all of these things, and stop giving credit to him. Instead, when those things happen, like, let's give, you know, praise and glory to God for keeping us safe through those things, for protecting us, and pray, you know, against them instead
Absolutely.
Of claiming those bad things against
and,
us.
You know, God yeah. knows our thoughts, but Satan doesn't.
Exactly.
And I can pray to the Father mm-hmm. By the Spirit of God in me and say things and share my heart with him without ever giving
exactly.
Satan an inkling of information about me.
Exactly. And also praying in that heavenly language as Amen. God has gifted us.
Yes.
If that's something that either you're pursuing or you have that gift of speaking in that heavenly language, speak it. Because let me tell you something, the devil can't understand
that's
it. He's confused by it. And that encourages me that I can speak that and find peace from the Holy Spirit.
The Bible says when you pray in the Spirit, you pray with wisdom and you pray with understanding.
Yes.
It's not human understanding. It is mm-hmm. the understanding that God has.
Yeah.
It is his language, prayer language through us, and it's powerful, and we should use it and utilize it. And, you know, I've heard people walk around, well, I'm afraid of this, or I'm mm-hmm. fearful of that. Just claiming those things. It's not just a matter, we shouldn't claim them anyways, because we shouldn't allow ourselves to believe those things. But
right.
if they are true, if they are things that we are dealing with, we should give them to the Father.
Yeah.
As you said, pray about them in the Spirit, or just pray about them in your heart. But don't let Satan know that he's getting at you mm-hmm. with fear and anxiety. Just don't keep claiming it out loud.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, we need to confide in people sometimes and let people know how to pray. But to just repeat it over and over is a challenge. Secondly, firstly, is knowing who the enemy is. Secondly, is knowing who you are. We have to know who we are. This
yeah.
is who we are. The Bible says we are sons and daughters of the Most High God. John chapter 1 verse 12 says, but to all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become the children of God. Now that is that's a stop and shout and praise God to just
yeah.
remind ourselves and remember that we are children of God. We are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus
Amen.
Christ. And 1 John chapter 3 verse 2 says, dear friends, we are already children of God. We are already, as believers, as those who, we're already there. We've been grafted in to the vine. And and then in Romans chapter 8, it calls us heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And because of that, we hold the keys of the kingdom of
yes.
God in our hand. We have authority.
Mm-hmm.
We have power. We have the anointing of God's Spirit. You talked about that in praying, in that
yeah.
prayer language that we're given as those who are baptized in the Spirit. But we need to use that power and authority we have. It's keys. You know, I know you. You're my daughter, so you always liked having keys.
Yeah.
As a little, you'd want my old keys. Anything, you'd love having keys. But there really is something symbolic about keys. You have some power and some authority
yeah.
when you have keys. And the Bible says that we are given keys to of the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 19, it says, "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on the earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." As children of God, we have authority.
Access. Yes, we have access, and that's what the keys give you, right? Into anything you have, access. Yes. We have access to God, and everything he has, he wants to give it to his children. So we have to understand that and grab hold of that. And something that helped me in that time of that attack from the enemy was grabbing hold of the truths of who God said I am and just speaking them out loud. I am a daughter of God. I am not defeated. I have the victory. All of these things. It's not in a prideful way because God has given it to us. So to say that you have the victory over these things constantly, that's what we should be saying more than, oh, I'm defeated. Oh, I'm depressed about this. Oh, I'm this. Like just proclaim those truths about what God says you are. Mm-hmm.
Amen. And then, you know, thinking about who we are, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6:19, it says, "Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body." We are literally the residence of God himself. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
We can sometimes grasp the concept of being his children, but to think about our body, our life as believers, we are the temple of God. We are the temple of his Holy Spirit. There's something powerful about that and recognizing that we house the very Spirit of God. It does a couple of things. One is it should give us confidence that greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world, but it also should give us a desire to keep that temple holy, to walk in a life that is upright and righteous and holy before God, because he dwells in a pure heart, in a clean temple. And so we want to make sure our life is always right before the Lord.
Yeah. And 1 John 4:4 says, "But you belong to God, my dear children. You have already won a victory over those people because the spirit who lives in you is greater than the spirit who lives in this world." You already said that, but that's the passage of scripture. And that is just something to hold on to. And we're walking through those times of feeling those attacks, that the spirit who lives in you is greater than the spirit who lives in this world. So nothing of this world can bring you down and defeat you, because the Holy Spirit that resides in us is what we need to win and have that victory.
And lastly, the last thing I want us to think about today as we're beginning to think about wrapping up this conversation is that we have to know where our strength comes from.
Yes.
Now, I think it's pretty evident from everything else we've said that we understand it comes from God. But, you know, there's some specific attributes and things that God gives us in his word that we need to grab a hold of so that we overcome and live this life of victory and power over the enemy of our soul. Mm-hmm. And one of that is knowing that the Bible tells us in Nehemiah that it is the joy of the Lord that is our strength. It's not just knowing but who he is or who we are in him, but it is knowing that he offers us joy. He wants us as his children, as his temple, to be filled with joy. And that joy, the joy that comes from God, gives us the strength to endure. It gives us strength. Nehemiah was helping to rebuild the wall, leading the charge to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. And it was in ruins, and he was being attacked on every side. He was being come against. And now he is saying, we're gonna have a feast. We're going to have some sacrifice. We're going to pray and seek God. And he says, we're being attacked. We're being overcome, but it is the joy of the Lord that's going to give us strength to overcome. And we have that joy available to us. We just got to tap into the joy of God.
Yeah. And joy is such a practical thing because it takes us stop dwelling in that attack, stop dwelling in those lies of the enemy, and choose joy. Yeah. It's about choosing it. Maybe we don't feel like it in the moment. Maybe we're not feeling this, oh, everything's great, everything's awesome, but we're choosing it. May our perspective of life be this of joy.
Amen.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in each of these other specific things about about knowing where our strength comes from, we've touched on through the rest of our conversation, but let's highlight them. We have the Word of God. You mentioned that you use the Word of God during your time of battle and struggle. Mm-hmm. It was the Word, the promises of God that gave you the ability to overcome. And Mom shares a personal testimony of the same thing, where she was having a spiritual battle many years ago. And what one thing she did is she just took a spiral notebook and opened up the Bible, and she just started writing scripture, just writing page. She filled up two or three spiral notebooks with just rewriting scripture, just rewriting it, rewriting, just writing it. For her was a key to overcoming. It helped it get inside of her, and she would just quote it and say it over and over.
Yeah.
And so it is the Word of God. And we should desire the Word of God.
Yes.
We should desire, it is strength to us. Bible. And we should get into it regularly, daily. And I would encourage anyone listening, especially if you're going through a battle, an attack of the enemy, but all of us, just as a regular discipline, if you don't already have a discipline of personal devotion and time in the Word of God every day, do it. Mm-hmm. It is life-changing, and it will help you overcome. And the next is prayer. Speak about prayer.
Yeah, prayer, I'm just going to read this scripture real fast, Isaiah 40:31. But those who trust, wait on in prayer by trusting the Lord, will find new strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. I don't know about you, but I get into some seasons of weariness, like I said before, where we can become vulnerable, where we can become weak at times. But prayer is what creates this strength within us, not by our own power, not by our own might, but by the Spirit within us. Our spiritual being is strengthened by prayer. And that's what allows us to combat the enemy. Whenever our spiritual being, when we are fueled by prayer, when we are in constant communication with God, there is nothing that can come against us, because we have that constant communication and in communion with God. Mm-hmm. And that's what's so sweet, is that we can approach God's throne boldly and talk with Him whenever, wherever we're at throughout our day. When we're feeling those feelings of anxiety, maybe fear, we can approach the throne room of God.
Amen. And that gives us the last point here of this point, and that is that we have the Holy Spirit in us, and you've brought that out a few times now. And in our prayer life, we pray in the Spirit. The Spirit of God dwells in us. Don't you know the verse we read a few minutes ago? Don't you know you are a temple of the Holy Spirit of God? His Spirit dwells in us, and He empowers us. It says in Ephesians 3:16, it says, I pray that from His glorious unlimited resources, He will empower you with it. Inner strength through His Spirit. And that is my prayer for every person who listens to this episode, is that God would empower them with inner strength by His Spirit. And He will do that. If you desire that, that's His Word. Yes. Every verse we've shared here, and we've shared a ton of verses here, because we did that intentionally, because God's Word is life. When you begin to apply God's Word to your circumstance, to your life, to your family, your finances, your health issues, your relationship issues, I'm going to tell you, the Word of God moves in. When you begin to quote it, declare it, speak it over your life, it comes in and it begins to break down walls and destroy things that the enemy's tried to put there. And it gives you a sense of joy and a sense of victory to overcome.
Yeah.
And you just keep doing it till you get the victory. James 4:8, we read 7 earlier, was our opening text, but I want to close with the next verse. It says, come close to God and God will come close to you. And that's my encouragement, is that we would all just come close, draw near to the Father, and watch as by His Spirit and by His power, He floods your life and fills you with authority and victory to break through whatever you're facing.
As a child of God, you do not have to be beaten down by Satan.
That's good.
We have to apply these biblical principles so that we can be victorious. So let's walk away from here. I'm encouraged by this conversation. I hope you are too. Let's walk out of here knowing that we don't have to be beaten down, because we have the victory through Jesus.
Amen. Candace, I want you to close us in prayer.
Yes.
I specifically want you to pray for anybody that's listening that is facing a spiritual attack, going through something right now, that God would help them get victory, that they would see the steps that they need to take to obtain this victory, and that they would have the faith and the courage to step out and just go after God with all their heart.
Amen.
Close us in prayer.
Yeah, wherever you're at, if you'll just create an atmosphere right now of an open heart and open spirit to the Holy Spirit, to God himself. He wants to meet you where you're at. Jesus, we come before you, Lord, boldly. Lord, your word says that as we come close to you, Lord, you come close to us. So Lord, we open ourselves to you right now, even in this moment, God, and we ask that you would come and meet us. Lord, for those that are listening that are facing spiritual attacks, maybe they feel like the enemy is attacking them on every side. They may feel these feelings of hopelessness, of fear, of anxiety. Lord, I know what it's like to be in those times and in those seasons, God, and I pray right now by the Spirit of God that you would meet them. Lord, would you just release your power and your peace over their lives? God, even someone right now that's sitting in their car after work, they feel defeated. They feel like they're not going to pay their bills in time. Their relationships are in shambles. They had a fight at work. Lord, whatever it is, there are so many different things in this world that are pulling for distractions and for fear and anxiety. Lord, I just pray that they would just feel a lift of those of those burdens. Lord, a lift of those burdens, and that your spirit would enter their vehicles, they would enter those rooms that they're sitting in, and that you would just provide a freedom and a victory that they have never felt before. God, right now, we just proclaim, Lord, your freedom over their lives, at those that are listening. God, I pray that each one would be equipped with what it takes to combat the enemy. Lord, equipped with your word, equipped with your power, equipped by prayer and praise. God, that we would have the joy that only comes from you,
yes,
your peace and your power to combat everything that comes our way. Lord, and I just pray, Lord, I know that this podcast is reaching people that are not even in Orange Park, but around the nation or even the globe. God, and I pray that these people would be able to take this word and carry it with them, Lord, and live in a place of victory. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that you are a God of victory. And we love you and we praise you and we give you glory for everything that you have done. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. And I'm believing for reports and praise reports of breakthrough and victory. Resist the enemy and he will flee from you. God bless you. Have a wonderful weekend. And if you're in the Orange Park, Florida area, join us for a Sunday worship service at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings. We'd love to get to know you. God bless.